morning and welcome to this mock arbitration. And I'm very excited that we can actually show you how a mock arbitration in the sense of a Wismut arbitration actually works. And can I just introduce the panel? And I also would like to point out that we have an all-female arbitration panel here, which you probably never would get in the real world. So or we basically are looking probably a few years in the future, into the future, yeah? So we have our chairwoman, and can I just say officially congratulations to her new appointment to the Supreme Court. I think it's great. So really like your first official job today. And my dear colleague, Professor Pilar Blaus from Madrid, Carlos Herreros. Then we have, as the claimants will introduce themselves, but I just want to quickly say, Catherine and David are the winning, Victoria University winning Wismut team of 2009, where they succeeded against 253 other teams. And then we have on our left, the respondents, Lisa Smagliolo, whom we need to congratulate for just being awarded her PhD when she came to New Zealand, and Professor Ulrich Schulter, and they are really nearly the first guard of the Wismut. So it's kind of, and I think with that, we should start. You should have a summary of the basically problem and pertinent kind of the legislation and rules in front of you.
Right, parties can introduce themselves, please.
Certainly, good morning. We represent the claimant in this proceeding, Mediterranean Trawler Supply. My name is Catherine Belton, and this is my co-counsel, Mr. David Hume. I was speaking to the procedural issue in dispute, and this has been respected as a standard issue.
Thank you, Ms. Belton. Mr. Hume.
We appear on behalf of the respondent, Equatoriana Fishing Limited. And we appear for the respondent, Equatoriana Fishing Limited. My colleague and I will present in respect to the jurisdiction procedural matter on my part. My colleague, Peter Schotter, will present on substantive issues. My name is Ms.
Thank you, Ms. Maniola and Mr. Schotter. Now, have the parties decided how they wish to proceed in this matter?
Yes, we have agreed that as respondent has contested the procedural problem, respondent will speak first on procedure, then claimant will respond. And I believe we have agreed that we would like to reserve some time for rebuttal if that is acceptable to the tribunal. And then as claimant has brought the proceeding, Mr. Hume will then lead on the substantive issue, and then Mr. Treasurer will lead for respondent.
So we're fine with the rebuttal, maybe. Right, Ms. Maniola.
Thank you. May I start with first pointing out that apparently we are in Fingerborn, So apparently we are in Vindobona, Danubia, although if you take careful notice of the signs outside, apparently we walked into Oceania, but let's suspend all disbelief and we are in fact in Danubia. Therefore, the arbitral clause, which is contained in the confirmation of sale, means that in fact, according to that, this seat of Danubia, where the model law on international commercial arbitration has been legislated, will apply, and also has chosen in that clause, the parties have chosen for the CTAC rules of arbitration to apply. That brings me to what I will be addressing on behalf of the respondent, which is the question about the challenge to the Honourable Professor Presiding Arbitrator. There are two bases upon which the challenge may be dealt with. The first is that there could be a voluntary withdrawal by either the member of the legal team in question, Dr. Mercado, who acts for the claimant, pursuant to Article 30, sub-Article 5 of the CTAC rules. Dr. Mercado could voluntarily withdraw from that team as part of an agreement between the parties as to how to deal with this challenge, or alternatively, pursuant to the same rule under CTAC rules, Professor Presiding Arbitrator could choose to voluntarily withdraw from the tribunal. The other method in which this challenge could be dealt with is pursuant to the model law. Article 19, sub-article 2, gives the tribunal discretion as to how to conduct the proceedings. And in our submission, that includes the possibility of removing Dr. Mercado from the claimant's legal team if the tribunal should see fit, and I'll talk to that in a moment. There are, of course, two bases for the challenge in this case. There is the professional relationship between Dr. Mercado and Professor Presiding Arbitrator. They are members of the same university faculty. They know each other on a first name basis. But this is not the sole ground of our objection, of course, because if we objected simply on this basis, perhaps the entire legal system of most countries would come to a grinding halt. However, there is, of course, also, most importantly, Professor Presiding Arbitrator's personal relationship with Dr. Mercado. The two are friends. Dr. Mercado is, in fact, a very close friend of all of the members of Professor Presiding Arbitrator's immediate family. The partner of Professor Presiding Arbitrator is very good friends and meets with Dr. Mercado on a regular basis. She is friends with her children and also, in fact, godmother to the youngest child of Professor Presiding Arbitrator as of October. Therefore, on that basis, we say there are grounds, in addition to the professional relationship, for a challenge to the position of Dr. Mercado on the legal team of the claimant, and alternatively to Professor Presiding Arbitrator's position on the tribunal for impartiality and neutrality concerns.
Councillor, can I just stop you there? But didn't you have time beforehand to actually challenge the presiding arbitrator? Isn't that now a little bit like, oh, we have nothing else to do, or we really want to try to, you know, upset the proceedings, and now you challenge, we could have done something beforehand. The timelines are not lapsed.
Indeed, thank you for that. It is quite true, the timelines in this case are a little unclear. However, it appears that from the time that Dr. Mercado was appointed and the declarations of independence of the arbitrators were filed, there is some 3 days before the statement of defence was filed, and in that statement of defence, we say that there is a challenge to the position of either and or Dr. Mercado and the presiding arbitrator. So we say that we haven't delayed in that. We've made the challenge clear within 3 days of being in a position to know of the potential conflict. In regard to whether that conflict is such that it endangers the impartiality and neutrality of this tribunal, I would simply draw the tribunal's attention, of course, to the International Bar Association guidelines and the various lists in those guidelines as to what may or may not potentially be a conflict of interest. The guidelines, of course, do not bind this tribunal, but they do provide some indication of best practice. There are red lists of either waivable types of relationships and red lists of non-waivable type. We don't say there's any non-waivable relationship here. There is also the orange list of the types of relationships that should be disclosed, and I might point out that no relationship was disclosed in the statements of independence
but
filed.
Sorry, I'm trying to interrupt you again, but Council, on those lists, is there the relationship of godmotherhood actually listed?
No, indeed, that godmothers and godfathers, for that matter, are not listed in those, quite predictably not listed in the IBA rules. However, there is the relationship of close family relationships between counsel and the arbitrator. We do not say that this is of the traditional family relationship type, but this is simply a number of examples that are provided by the IBA, and indeed the rules say these are non-exhaustive, they are just examples. And what we seek to do is to say that this relationship is very similar to many of those that are listed. So I should also point out, under the orange list, close personal relationships will also qualify as something that should be disclosed. And our submission is that the type of relationship here, although not specifically listed, is of such that were you to simply slot it in under the waivable red list, it wouldn't look out of place at all. It is a close personal relationship between the two. And in addition to that, a professional relationship, although not of a significant financial kind. And therefore, in combination, certainly, this would not look out of place in the IBA guidelines.
Councillor, excuse me, but there is a personal relationship between presiding arbitrator and Dr. Mercado, or is Dr. Mercado with the presiding arbitrator's wife?
Yes, you raise a very valid point, and certainly I don't think anyone would deny there's a close personal relationship with Professor Presiding Arbitrator's partner. However, we say because there is a close relationship between every member of the immediate family of the President, that in itself would constitute a close personal relationship with the President. But in addition to that, we also must remember there is a professional connection as well as that. And these things in combination must amount to a close personal professional relationship of such that it should at least be declared, if nothing else.
Well, what's the relationship between being declared and actually being a relationship that's disqualifying? Because there are many relatively close friendships between members of the bar and arbitrators, especially arbitrators who operate as members of the bar. There are often very close professional relationships with people being in the same chambers, for instance, who operate in this way. So what do you say is meant by close personal relationships, and also looking very closely at the relationship between counsel as against the relationship with parties, which of course are quite in a different category?
Yes, certainly it's valid to say that something that must be disclosed, such as things on the orange list of the IBA rules, they may or may not lead to grounds for disqualification. However, they are there because they need to be tested, and this is what we submit is the case here, that this is one that needs to be tested and therefore may in fact ground justifiable doubts, which is the key here under the CTAC rules. If there are justifiable doubts that on an objective basis a third party in a reasonable position looking at the types of relationship might have justifiable doubts as to the impartiality, that is enough for this to be a valid charge. So here we say that there are multiple relationships. There's not just one. There is a professional one, and then there is a personal one with the partner, but also for each of the children, and in addition to that, the special significance of being godmother. But if I may just move now, because I think I don't have very much time left. Our argument is obviously that there are justifiable doubts here as to the neutrality, but further than that, we submit that here neutrality or justice, if you like, interchangeable in this case, must not only be done but seen to be done. And the worst thing that the tribunal can do here is allow this to fester and continue to plough on without dealing with it and resolving it at this early point in the proceedings. Our submission is this would simply result in a challenge to this proceeding under the model law in the courts, or if an award were to be issued, that would be very vulnerable to challenge under the New York Convention. And we would conclude in our submission that the most prudent course is the best one that this tribunal can take, that either Dr. Mercado resign by agreement or a withdrawal by the President to recuse herself from the matter, or alternatively, the tribunal use its discretionary power to remove the member of the legal counsel on the basis that it's a potential abuse of process to allow a member of legal counsel to be added without the potential for removal by the tribunal where there is a close relationship. Otherwise, a legal team could simply use that as a mechanism for triggering a challenge, and that could be an abuse of process and endanger arbitration. So where that happens, there is good grounds to say that the tribunal should use its discretionary power under the model law. We might also point out that if there were to be an agreement between the parties as to the removal of either Dr. Mercado or the President, or if the President were to voluntarily withdraw pursuant to the CTAC rules, that the CTAC rules explicitly say that that does carry no implication as to the basis, that whether that substantive ground or challenge has been upheld or not, and so that's important to bear in mind as well. I might just briefly mention also there is a procedure under the CTAC rules for this tribunal to suspend the proceeding at this point and to have the matter, if there can be no agreement between the parties, determined by the chairman of the CTAC.
So that is another alternative.
Can I just check what you say in respect of the power to remove counsel given the right to counsel of choice? Because those are important rights, and what do you say about the linkage between those?
Yes, there are a number of scholars who have written specifically on this point, and there have been cases on point as well. Certainly there is, of course, the freedom of the parties to engage whichever counsel they like, and that autonomy must be respected, but like most freedoms, there have to be limits. And where that freedom is exercised, or there's a potential for it to be exercised, in such a way as it becomes an abusive process, our submission is that, as most scholars in this area would say, that must be curtailed where the potential is, or it has been used, to disrupt proceedings by triggering a challenge from the other side and having the proceedings endangered.
And counsel, can you assist the tribunal with any of the case law?
No, I don't have it to hand, but I certainly can provide you with a number of those cases.
And can I check, is there an allegation in this case that this has been done to disrupt a proceeding, or is it merely something that's happened? So, and if there is an allegation that it's been done to disrupt, can you please provide the basis for that submission?
We don't submit that it has been done for that purpose here. When I was mentioning about abusive process, I'm simply saying that there's a policy reason why the tribunal might choose to exercise its discretion in that manner. Is there any other question the tribunal wish to raise?
No, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. To start off, we would agree with the points that counsel for respondent has stated, that we are seated in Danubia here, the CTAC rules apply, and we are also operating under the model law. Now, turning to our procedural matter at hand, counsel for respondent or respondent have requested that Dr. Mercado, who is a part of our legal team, either voluntarily withdraw from the case, or that the arbitral tribunal make an order that Dr. Mercado be removed, or they have suggested in the alternative that the presiding... Or that the presiding arbitrator voluntarily withdraw. Now, our position is that we agree with counsel for respondent that the arbitral tribunal has an inherent power to control the procedure of these proceedings today, and that, as counsel for respondent pointed out, can be found in Article 19 of the Model Law, which provides a wide discretion to control proceedings. And we would also say it is found in Article 30 of the CTAC rules, which states that the arbitral tribunal may examine the case in any manner it sees fit. Naturally, that language is slightly strange, but the general meaning is clear that the discretion is there. Now, in light of, I would like to refer to the two ICSID cases, which are Hrvatska in Slovenia and Rompetrol in Romania. And these were two decisions which dealt with this question of removal of counsel, and also questioned how far this tribunal's inherent power extends. Now, in light of those decisions, we say that the inherent power of the tribunal to control proceedings by removing counsel does exist, but only exists in case of exceptional circumstances and where, as the presiding arbitrator has pointed out, that there is some question of abuse of the arbitral process involved.
Counsel, before you start telling us more about that, why should we take exit decisions into account where we are commercial?
Well, I have two answers on that. First of all, yes, we are under commercial arbitration, and indeed ICSID is actually distinct in that it allows for the arbitral tribunal itself to decide on questions of challenge, whereas in international commercial arbitration proceedings, that is usually, if not always, undertaken by the arbitral institution or a neutral third party. So we say these ICSID decisions are of potentially limited relevance, but given that they deal with the question of removal of counsel and inherent power, we say that's still analogous to commercial arbitration. Naturally, of course, I think the second point you might have been getting at, Dr. Butler, is that arbitration knows no system of precedent. So we do not say in any way that these cases are binding, or that you should consider yourself bound to a doctrine of stare decisis that we should look at that, but merely that these cases provide some guidance to deal with the question here today. So, to just briefly summarise our position, the inherent power of the arbitral tribunal should not be exercised in the manner requested by counsel for respondent. Dr. Mercado does not need to be removed. So I have two main submissions to make here. Is in essence, the tests, if they do exist, as seen in Hrvatska, Slovenia, and Grand Patrol Romania, are not satisfied in this case, and that in any event, Article 30 of the CTAC rules provides the normal challenge procedure. And in this case, there is nothing exceptional, there is no abuse of process to suggest that we should depart from that normal procedure where respondent has legitimate concerns as to any question of bias. So turning back to the first submission, the tribunal's inherent powers ought not to be exercised in this case because the test, if any, for removal of counsel is not satisfied. Now we would say the test is two-pronged, that there must be an appearance of bias or justifiable doubts as to bias, as counsel for respondent pointed out, and that can be seen in the IBA rules, and that the second prong of the test is that there must be exceptional circumstances. Now, counsel for respondent spoke about the IBA rules and we talked about red list, orange list and green list. Now, as we can obviously already guess, red list means stop. You should not be appearing on or partaking in the case because there is a real question of bias. Orange is to say, stop, think about this for a little bit, maybe you should disclose it, but it's not fatal to an arbitrator continuing if the connection is on an orange list. And the green list, full steam ahead, there's no problem here. Now we say that the professional relationship which does exist in this case. Dr. Mercado is a lecturer at the Danubia University, and Madam Presiding Chair is also a lecturer at Danubia University. Now, we would point out that the green list of the IBA guidelines on conflicts of interest says that where there is a relationship with another arbitrator, with counsel for one of the parties, through membership in the same professional association or social organisation, that is absolutely no problem. And we say the professional relationship fits on there. So that has to be taken out of the equation.
Can I just check, I understand that the challenge is also on the basis that there was perhaps some patronage in terms of Dr. Mercado getting the job in the first place. Whether there's an allegation of continuing patronage, I'm not certain. But what do you say in relation to that aspect of the professional relationship?
Certainly from the facts of the case, it would appear that Dr. Mercado did not apply for the position herself, but was rather requested to apply by Madam Presiding Arbitrator's secretary. However, we are aware from the record that various other applicants were also invited to apply in this manner. And as the reason that our party chose to appoint Dr. Mercado to its legal team, Dr. Mercado is an expert in international arbitration in Danubia. So it is no surprise that Madam Presiding Arbitrator would also wish that she was part of the faculty and not for any reason of personal relationship, but simply because of the expertise that Dr. Mercado has. So if we turn briefly to the personal relationship that Dr. Mercado has with Madam Chair's immediate family and that she is a godparent. Now, as counsel for respondent said, this is not a traditional close relationship, and it certainly doesn't fall within the IBA rules. As Dr. Butler pointed out, there's nothing in here that speaks to godparents. Now, we don't know the role of godparents. Roles can usually vary widely, so I'm not going to go into that. But what I want to point out here is that the personal relationship with Dr. Mercado is with Madam Chair's family and not with Madam Chair. The relationship with Madam Chair is simply a professional one, and the record clearly states that the personal relationship time spent is with the immediate family members. Now,
Counsel, sorry to stop you there, is that a little bit like splitting hairs?
It might be a little bit splitting hairs, but the fact remains that the time spent, Dr. Mercado, is not with Madam Chair. It is with the other family members, and there's nothing to suggest that Madam Chair is also there and that there is a complete personal relationship.
What did you say about what's meant by close personal relationship in terms of in terms of the IBA categories in any event. So do you accept that a close friendship of some manner, because the reason it's the same, the flip side of the question that I asked your friend, in terms of there are close relationships between members of the bar.
Yes.
And where is the line drawn in terms of when they are disqualifying as against merely something that should be disclosed?
Well, that is a difficult question. Where do we draw the line? And I guess the answer, the best answer to that is we know it when we see it. And in this case, there's nothing to see here. So what the IBA guidelines do, as Council of Respondents say, is they provide some examples of where we should be questioning what is going on in that relationship. And we say that here the main relationship between Madam Chair and Dr. Mercado is a professional one, and certainly there is a close personal tie between the members of the family of Madam Chair and Dr. Mercado, but that says nothing as to Madam Chair's ability to remain impartial and independent as required under the CTAC rules. So we say that on that first limb of the test, there is nothing on the IBA guidelines that would suggest that the test of justifiable doubts is satisfied. So we say that the first limb has not been satisfied. However, even if there was...
Excuse me, Councillor. According to the facts, Dr. Mercado has appeared with a Madam presiding arbitrator in other cases, and even there was even a dissenting opinion issued by Madam Chair. Does this factor have any impact upon the decision we should make here?
I understand you're referring to the three previous instances, and there were, in two of those instances, the party that Dr. Mercado represented was successful in the arbitration, and one was not, and Madam Chair issued a dissenting opinion. Now, I have absolutely no information on those proceedings, as arbitration tends to be confidential and certainly private, but I would say that Dr. Mercado is an experienced litigator, and there is no reason for any patronage there, but rather that the merits of the case suggested that Dr. Mercado and her client be successful.
And in this situation, however, do you think that, or is your opinion that maybe Dr. Mercado should have, or Madam presiding arbitration should have had disclosed this matter, because as it happens in the other cases, it was not disclosed? Do you think disclosure would be here a factor that we should consider at the arbitral tribunal?
I would not want to speak on behalf of Madam Chair as to when disclosure is appropriate or not. That must be taken by the arbitrator, that decision. However, we do know in literature and in recent times, parties will challenge whatever they can. So if one is going to disclose every single tiny connection, then that just leaves room for challenge later on down the track. So I think the reasonable common sense position is not to disclose minor relationships which do not affect the ability of the arbitrator to be impartial and independent. And we say that's what happened here. So turning just to that second part of the test, there are no exceptional circumstances in this case that would justify the use of the tribunal's power to remove Dr. Mercado. So to briefly cover off the facts in Hrvatska and Slovenia, because that is the key case I want to look at here, where counsel was removed. Now in that case, Mr. David Williams was the chair of the arbitral tribunal, and Mr. David Milden QC was appointed at the 11th hour by respondent to appear in a hearing before. Now the problem there was that Mr. David Milden and Mr. David Williams were members of the same barrister's chambers. Now barrister's chambers are explicitly referred to in the IBA guidelines that should not be a problem, but probably fits on the orange list and maybe should be disclosed, especially for parties who are not familiar with the English system of barrister's chambers, because barristers are individual practitioners, but in recent times they do obviously share resources, and that has become a closer relationship. However, the problem in Hrvatska was not the fact that they were from the same chambers, but it was that respondent had appointed Dr. Milden at the 11th hour, at a late stage in the proceedings, refused to disclose to claimant, despite repeated requests, the role that Mr. Milden would be playing and how long he had been actually active in the case. So Mr. David Williams said in the judgment, which excluded Mr. Milden, that what respondents' actions have done, whether or not this was a tactical means taken by a respondent to disrupt or not, I can't speak to that, but I would suggest not. The problem was that the way that they had behaved created a situation of mistrust which the arbitral tribunal had to deal with. And because both parties did not want to contact the tribunal or to have Mr. David Williams removed from the tribunal and therein create a longer process of appointment, they decided that the best way to resolve all problems and to remove that distrust was to ask Mr. Melbourne to refrain from continuing. So in that case, there was an exceptional circumstance that this mistrust atmosphere had been created, and there is none of that here. Our client, as soon as we appointed Dr. Mercado, that was disclosed both to the arbitral tribunal and to opposing counsel, and we merely appointed Dr. Mercado because she is an expert in international arbitration and not for any means to disrupt the tribunal. Further, we would point out if our client really did want to disrupt the tribunal, we would have appointed someone where there's a clear red list connection and not a green list, maybe an orange list.
There doesn't seem to be any suggestion that there was a...
No, we do accept that counsel for respondent, this was not done for any abusive reasons. Now, I'm sure that my time is probably very limited, so I will finish there, unless the tribunal has any questions, because I do have some wonderful policy arguments for you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Galton. And do we have a rebuttal?
Yes, I'll just take up a few of those points and deal with them. There are only so many hairs you can split before it becomes a bit too abstract. And to take the professional relationship out of the equation, we say it's simply splitting one hair to refer to the distinction between the chair herself and the chair's family is another splitting of hairs. And after that, it becomes just a little bit too theoretical. So we would ask that the tribunal consider the matter as a whole and whether the overall picture that this would present to an objective third party is one which might raise justifiable doubt. The ICSID cases that were referred to, Hrvatska and Rompetrol, where the counsel were removed, in regard to that and the question of whether a two-pronged test should be applied by this tribunal, whereby the second prong is there must be exceptional circumstances. As the tribunal correctly pointed out, those were not necessarily commercial cases in the sense of this one, and our submission is that where state interests are involved, there may well be reasons for a very different type of test because of the additional considerations when state parties are taking part in the proceedings and the effect of that on the award that has to be enforced somewhere. So we say that exceptional circumstance test is not relevant to these proceedings. And finally, just in relation to a point brought up by the chair in regard to patronage, we do not rely upon the patronage of on the record of the chair or the chair's faculty as such in relation to Dr. Mercado. We also don't rely upon the record of successes and failures of legal teams that have appeared with Dr. Mercado in those teams before the chair. We simply point to the relationships as such, and we say that that is enough. All of those relationships together are enough to give rise to justifiable doubt. And in relation to that, also I might just point out that the CTAC statement of independence that the arbitrators are required to submit seeks disclosure of any circumstance that could lead to justifiable doubt in the mind of any party. And that, again, underlines this idea that it has to be simply justifiable doubt. And we may well have in the mind of Dr. Mercado, of course, a very professional and experienced lawyer, but it's the doubt that it raises in the mind of a party such as a respondent that really counts here, and that's what we seek to rely upon.
Thank you very much. We'll now move to the substantive. Can I just check whether a rebuttal is sought for the substantive argument as well?
Yes.
Yes, and we're happy with that. Thank you, Mr. Hume.
Thank you. Honourable members of the tribunal, I'll present the claimant's submissions on the substantive element of this dispute, and in short, the claimant's case is that it paid the respondent for squid, which it had made clear to the respondent were to be used as bait in the longline fishing industry. but the majority of the screws the respondent ultimately provided could not be used as bait, and the claimant now seeks damages reflecting the loss associated with the non-conformity with the contract. To just clarify the governing laws, the UN Convention on Contracts for the International Sale of Goods, and that operates due to Article 1.1 of that convention, the CISG, because both the claimant and respondents have their home countries have adopted the CISG. And under the CISG, as opposed to any domestic law, the claimant must establish two things to make out its claim. The first is that the goods supplied were not in conformity with the contractually agreed standard. And second, that the claimant conducted an adequate inspection of the goods when it received them, and this is notwithstanding that that inspection didn't in fact detect the non-conformity at the time. And on that first point then, of non-conformity, there are two legal bases under the CISG on which the claimant alleges non-conformity can be established. The first is under Article 35(2)(c) of the CISG. And that provides that the goods must be fit for any particular purpose that's been expressly or impliedly made known to the seller. And of course, this is subject to the requirement that it be reasonable that the claimant in this case could rely on the seller's skill and judgment. The second argument is that under 35(2)(b) of the CISG, which is that the goods must be possess the qualities of goods which the seller has held out to the buyer as a sample or model, and in this case there was a sample provided. So before delving deeper into the legal issues, it's probably best to traverse some of the key facts of the case. So the claimant, the first important thing to know is that the claimant, though it's a experienced supplier of bait to fishing fleets in its region, is not experienced in purchasing bait using bait from the respondent's region. And the only reason that the claimant is ever contracted with the respondent was because bait from its local fisheries was in short supply, and so it was forced to look elsewhere to cast its net further afield, if you will. So as a result of that shortage, it issued a request for offers from providers. And if you see in the record, claimant's exhibit number one, the statement is reasonably concise but clear. Mediterranean supply, Trawler Supply is interested in purchasing squid for resale to the longliner fishing fleet based in Mediterranean to be used as bait. Now that's a very important statement. It sets the tone for what follows. In May, the respondent...
Your position is that the mere indication that it's to be used as bait has a particular meaning in the industry that would then, or what is, perhaps the better way of asking that is, what do you say that means in terms of the case?
So that means that a particular purpose has been communicated to the respondent for use as bait, and moreover, given both the claimant and the respondent's experience in general in the fishing industry, they'll both know that bait needs to be of a certain size to be useful. Now,
so you're relying on the experience to say that it has to be of a certain size, rather than the saying that there is perhaps an inherent in the industry understanding in terms of bait, or is it both of those?
I think there could be an argument as to trade usage as well,
yes.
But for our purposes we can look to that statement of bait as quite the experience, but also subsequent communication. So the respondent then provided a sample of squid to the claimant, and the claimant provided that in turn to its customers, and all were satisfied with it. In fact, the claimant indicated that it was particularly pleased that the samples shown to us fell almost exclusively in the range of 100 to 150 grams. And that's important, again, because of that experience of both parties. And they know that bait, to be effective in the longline fishing industry, needs to be in that range. You could call it the Goldilocks zone. If If it's too heavy, it'll fall off the line. If it's too light, it won't be appetizing to the fish, it won't be useful at all. So on that basis, an order form was provided, and that order form specified, if I can direct the tribunal's attention to claimant's exhibit number 3, and this is quite short form, but indicates as per sample inspected. And that entire sample, as I say, almost exclusively fell within that range.
Councillor, but we do have claimant's exhibit number 4, don't we?
Yes, indeed, indeed.
And I'm sure you know what I'm going to ask you, but it says under catch, the 2007 and 2008 catch. And we also know from the fact that, of course, the earlier the season is, the squid hasn't eaten enough, so it's not as heavy. Shouldn't your client have at that moment at least alarm bells ringing that the sample in the end, what they're contracted for, might not be quite the same?
I think with 2020 hindsight, that's a very easy conclusion to reach. But I think in the context of the contractual negotiations, we must look at the relative knowledge of the parties. And here we see that the claimant had indicated that the bait was to be used for long line fishing. It had indicated the particular size range was the one that was necessary for its clients.
Can I just stop you there? You say it indicated a particular size range. Are you suggesting that that was indicated expressly? It's certainly not in the documentation of it as such.
Not in the contractual purchase order, but in the cover letter to the purchase order.
So you say that that has effectively at least invested them with knowledge?
Indeed.
But Councillor, it doesn't mean that the lighter squid does not have any results. It just might not have the best results. But you cannot say that because the squid is a little bit smaller, you have no fish eating them.
I think results are key in this case, and you can't argue with them. What happened in the end was that the claimant did take delivery of the squid provided by the respondent. Provided those on to 5 different trawlers, 2 of which returned to port after putting out to sea, having not been able to catch fish with those squid. 3 others remained at sea, but put aside the squid provided by respondent and instead used other supplies, and so returned that squid in due course. So that squid was too small to be effective, practically speaking. And on subsequent investigation, it was found out that it was in fact made up of 2 separate batches, 2007 and 2008 squid, but in fact what had transpired happened was at the time the respondent was responding to the claimant's purchase order, it had run out of, or largely run out of, 2007 vintage squid, if you will. 2008 squid then it sought to use to make up the deficit, and it knew that that would be young squid, that it would be most likely less than 100 grams, so outside of that range. But it didn't communicate this to the claimant, save for the fact that it included that oblique reference to the time frame in which the squid may have been catched, 2007-2008 catch. It doesn't specify what portion 2008 catch might be. On some level, perhaps a couple of cartons of 2008 catch could be included, and the contract would not be in non-conformity. So there's no issue there, I think, as to the claimant's knowledge at the time. The important thing to know, though, is that the particular purpose was made known, a sample was approved, and that for the respondent to then say, by some sleight of hand in acceptance, that notwithstanding all of those prior indications, it was now going to supply goods that were substantially not fit for the purpose made known, i.e. fishing, would be too much to ask. Something would smell fishy, as it were, in the manner in which they conducted that contractual negotiation. I don't think you could expect the claimant would have agreed to that had its attention really been drawn to that modification, even if it were the case. So in short, then to go back to 35.2c, a sample was provided. It was approved by the claimant, and even the respondent's response, even including that purported caveat also stated as per sample already received. The quality of that sample was within the range, and so claimant was entitled to believe that any further delivery would be within that range as per sample. But leaving that aside and in the alternative, the particular purpose had been made known to use the bait in longline fishing, as well as the fact that claimant was in total reliance on the respondent in this regard because it did not purchase this particular species of squid in the ordinary course of its business, but the respondent did do so.
Can I just check with you in terms of your sample argument? The sample argument is related to quality.
Yes.
Now, do you say size is part of quality in this context, or the other argument, of course, might be that quality means grade A, iced on board, fit for human consumption, which is the wording that comes after the as per sample received on the contract note.
Certainly, I'd say those would all form part of quality, but you could not avoid the fact that size of the sample is also an indicator of the quality of the goods, and that's where the reference to the sample comes in.
Might be that it's not explicitly stated, so you have to be relying therefore on the context of saying in bait terms that size is part of quality, but it was not explicitly stated. So what are you relying on to say that size is part of quality when it's not explicitly stated?
So there's two interpretive courses we can take. We could say that the statement as per sample inspected then relates in the purchase order solely to what follows after that statement, and therefore it's exclusive. Or we could say that that's in fact an inclusive statement. It refers not only to what follows, but also what other qualities the sample contained. So that is the second inclusive interpretation is what the claimant argues for. The only other point to flag on that score is that fitness for human consumption is an ordinary requirement for for squid to be used as bait, where it's stored alongside fish for human consumption in the warehouse. Now, I know time is against me, so if I may just ask for 2 more minutes to address the inspection question, and it can be dealt with relatively briefly. There is a requirement in the CISG under Article 38 that the buyer must inspect the goods as soon as reasonably practicable after receiving them. Now, if the buyer does not do this, then it's unable to complain of non-conformity, but there are 2 points to note on this score. The claimant did discharge this positive obligation. It did inspect the goods on receipt. 12 containers arrived in the course of 1 day. It took samples from 2 of those. It defrosted 5 cartons out of a sample of 20 cartons that had been weighed. In defrosting those cartons, it effectively made those goods unsaleable, but on weighing them, found that those samples were in fact within the necessary range. They were satisfied on that basis. Were unwilling, of course, to incur further cost in destroying further cartons or storing goods while they conducted further inspections. But second, and in any event, Article 38 is subject to Article 40 of the CISG, and that says that the seller is not entitled to rely on the provisions of Article 38 if the lack of conformity relates to facts that the seller knew or could not have been unaware and which he did not disclose to the buyer. And here the seller knew that the bulk of the shipment would be made up of 2008 squid. Of the 120 containers, 72 of them were this 2008 squid, this young squid that was undersized. Moreover, that it knew that this squid would be in that range potentially, but it did not disclose this to the claimant. The statement 2007-2008 catch, as I've already adverted to, doesn't tell you anything about what portion of the delivery would ultimately be made up of those 2008 squid. So, that being the case, the claimant respectfully requests the tribunal enter an award in its favour.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kim. Move over to Mr. Schroeder.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I have heard with great interest the legal analysis that my learned friend has presented as to the matter of non-conformity of the goods, and you will not be surprised to hear that I do not agree with this position. I will point out in the next 10 minutes two issues that my learned friend has addressed. First of all, I will present to you the reasons why my client delivered goods that were in perfect conformity with the contract and the convention. And secondly, I will demonstrate that even if that should not have been the case, the claimant has lost any right he might have had to rely on a lack of conformity because he failed to give notice of non-conformity within reasonable time as required under Article 39 of the Convention. The first issue largely pertains to Article 35 of the Convention, and counsel for the claimant has relied on Articles 35, paragraph 2, B, A, and C, and seemingly a combination of the three. He conveniently leaves out the first part of Article 35, paragraph 2, which reads, except where the parties have agreed otherwise, the standards under subparagraph A to C come into play. It is my submission that our case is precisely such a case. The parties did agree otherwise. In their contract contained in claims exhibit number 4.
Can I particularly suggest then that the parties agreed that it wouldn't be fit for purpose?
Yes, absolutely. The parties agreed on the sale of unsized squid, and they did not include in their quite extensive contract any remark to this particular line that was contained in a, not even a particular letter sent to my client, but an email sent to a variety of suppliers a number of weeks earlier, and that then never reoccurred during the contract negotiations.
So, leaving aside the size question, you're suggesting that they didn't even agree that it would be sold as bait?
Yes, absolutely. That's my argument. I believe that what we should look at when applying Article 35, paragraph 1, is claims exhibit number 4, because that was the last offer that was left on the table at the end of the day, which the sent an email sent by my client on 29th of May 2008, and the claimant accepted that email, or that offer rather, on the same day by email, claimant's exhibit number 5. Article 35, paragraph 1 tells us that the seller must deliver goods which are of the quantity, quality, and description required by the contract. The contract contained in claimant's exhibit number 4 clearly that outlines what that is. The quantity, approximately 200 metric tons. The quality, as per sample, already received grade A, fit for human consumption. And then the description, which is contained in the line just above it, catch, 2007-2008. When interpreting the contract, one has to take into account the usages within the trade, within the fishing trade. And that is that squid is sold either sized or unsized. Sized squid is caught and then sized mechanically or by sight. So the buyer of sized squid knows exactly which size he is going to get. On the other hand, sized squid is usually more expensive because it takes an additional working step to sort out the squid. Unsized squid, on the other hand, is not sized. And what a contract for unsized squid is for, I can describe no better than by quoting from the menu of the Wellington Harbourfront restaurant I had the pleasure of having dinner at 2 nights ago, where the term market fish was described by changes daily depending on what the tide brings in. That is exactly what you get when you order unsized squid, and if you want to be more specific, you designate which catch that unsized squid comes for.
Can I just take you back to the issue of purpose? Are you suggesting that in order to bring in the purpose and fit for purpose, that you would have to put specifically in the contract itself rather than the initial offer that this was for bait purposes?
Absolutely, that's what I'm suggesting. I'm suggesting that what was actually put in the offer that my client made, there was no reference to bait whatsoever.
So in fact, in terms of fitness for purpose, if I say I want wood to build a house, and I don't put that into the contract, but it's clearly been made on that basis,
so it's not put into the contract, and the only thing that's put in is size, that in fact I can't say, well, this isn't suitable for building a house that would only be suitable for firewood.
Well,
if in fact it's been provided in the sizing and the type of quality that's noted.
Well, if it has been provided in the size and quality that's noted, I don't think that would be a reasonable argument. But the case we have here is different, because in our case, under quality, the quality is specifically provided in great detail what this wood would have to be like, and also, and that's the trigger point, they put in cash 2008. Isn't it remarkable that in this quite detailed contract, all kinds of details are mentioned, including the cash, but there is nothing about size.
This is fantastic, Council. Can I just stop you there? Because we have claimant exhibit number 2, don't we? And under the CSG, we can actually take the negotiations of the parties into account. And as in exhibit number 2, and it's been quoted by the Council for Claimant already, we were particularly pleased that the samples shown to us fell almost exclusively in the range of 100 to 150 grams. This is particularly important, since that is the range that gives our customers the best results. And don't we have to interpret claimant exhibit number 4 in accordance with claimant exhibit number 2?
Well, I believe that Article 8 tells us that the interpretation has to take into account all relevant circumstances, and I would argue that that is just one of them. I would say that the email written by the claimant after he had inspected the sample did in no way change his decision to order unsized squid and not the more expensive sized squid. He weighed it, he inspected it as to the quality, which in my reading of the contract and the contractual negotiations refers to the quality fit for human consumption issue of the squid. And when weighing it, he found out that, well, this unsized squid actually precisely fits our size requirements. Isn't that good? We don't have to buy the more expensive sized ones. And he failed to do that. It is my submission that that was entirely the claimant's risk. He could have put a size requirement in, but then the price would have gone up. He failed to do so. And in such a circumstance, I believe it would be unreasonable to read into a specific contract, all of which requirements my client lived up to, an additional requirement that was mentioned amongst numerous other issues in contractual negotiations. I believe that in our situation, the contract made entirely clear it was for unsized squid of the 2007-2008 catch, and that's what my client delivered.
Would it be possible for this tribunal, we have not made, neither of the parties has made this allegation, but would it be possible for this arbitral tribunal, and thus do we have the power, to conclude that this might be a case of mistake of the parties in regard to the quality, size of the goods, and then to declare the contract void?
It would be my submission that no, you would have no legal basis for such a conclusion, because a mistake, even if there was one on one of the parties' side, which I cannot tell, would not give you ground to conclude the contract could be avoided because of that reason, because Article 35 of the CSG governs exhaustively what the legal consequences of such a case would be. In our case, it is simply that the respondent fulfilled its contract. That rule should not be circumvented by relying on domestic law. At the end of the day, and concluding my issue number one, I think whenever the party orders unsized squid, there is a catch to it, if you forgive me the pun, because you don't know exactly what size you're going to get. As we know from history, in rare occasions, the squid caught can be exceptionally small or exceptionally large, like the specimen contained in this building on floor 4, which, as I found out this morning, it was 2007 cash. I will now turn to my second issue, the failure of the claimant to inspect and notify my client about the alleged nonconformity in time. Article 39 requires the buyer to inspect, well, to notify the seller about any nonconformity he has detected or ought to have detected within reasonable time after he ought to have detected it. Article 38 requires the buyer to conduct an inspection. When the buyer, the claimant in our case, received on 1st of July 2008 a total of 20,000 cartons of squid from my client, he chose to defrost and inspect 5 of them. That is an exceptionally small number, and the fact that this standard doesn't live up to the standard of a reasonable inspection should be self-evident.
Can we just object, because obviously in this circumstance what you have is when you inspect you destroy. So it's not a situation where you can inspect and still use. So what effect do you say that has on the issue of sample? Because obviously if you could inspect but not destroy, then one might expect a larger percentage.
I would very much agree with you, Madam Chair, that the factor that the goods were destroyed in our case could influence the number of specimen that would have to be expected, the sample. However, I suggest that we put that in commercial terms and look to the number or to the commercial effect that the destruction of the samples actually had. If we look to the party's contract in claimants exhibit number 4, we see that one carton of squid was priced at $16. The claimant inspected and defrosted 5 of them, thus he invested a total of $80 in order to find out about a defect, which at the end of the day resulted in a damage claim of $479,450. He is now trying to get back from my client. So I believe that under the circumstances that we have here, it would have been not only reasonable but necessary to inspect a larger number and to defrost a larger number of cartons in order to find out about the deficiency that now has given rise to the mess we are facing here.
What do you say about inspecting 5 cartons and finding their inconformity and assuming from that that the remainder are in conformity? Because, If one had inspected and found that some of them weren't in conformity, then one might have expected that one goes further. But given that you are destroying the sample and you found them perfectly in conformity and also in conformity with the sample, don't you take that into account in working out whether there's been a sufficient inspection?
I would believe that the number 5 is not the only decisive issue we have here. It's also a number, the question how the sample was selected.
Well, absolutely. Perhaps you could address us on that point.
True. Certainly. The 5 cartons that were defrosted were all taken from the first 2 containers of 12 containers delivered. The other 10 containers were left completely untouched. The 5 cartons all had all printed on them 2007 catch, while the contract explicitly called for 2007/2008 catch. So I believe a random selection would have required, if 5 cartons would be selected, then take one from every second container and defrost it, but not 5 from the certain 2 and let the other 10 just sit there. Had the claimant done so, he would have found out at that particular moment. And the situation we are in here would have been perfectly avoided. One point the claimant has relied upon is Article 40 of the CSG, which tells us the seller, my client, is not entitled to rely on Articles 38 and 39 if the lack of conformity relates to facts of which she knew or could not have been unaware. I believe that that is not the case we have here. It's quite clear from the fact that my client did not know what the goods specifically would be used for, specifically whether the exact size and what size would give good or not so good results for the Mediterranean fishing fleet. That is clear from the response my client sent back to the claimant when he was informed that a number of fishing vessels had returned to port and had pointed out that the catch wasn't as they had expected. My client apparently did not know why that was the case and requested that the buyer, that the claimant has the squid inspected. Please have it inspected by a certified text agency. We are very surprised to hear that. In order to have Article
40. Okay, can we just, which exhibit are you referring to?
I'm referring to claims exhibit number 6, which is on page 13 of the file.
Okay.
it is the reaction of my client or my client's sales manager to the notice that something allegedly was wrong with the squid. And it seems to me, if we turn one page back, claimant's exhibit number 5, even the claimant himself wasn't quite clear what exactly that deficiency was. Both vessels reported that the squid was hardly usable as bait. It doesn't refer to size. It doesn't refer to quality. So even the claimant wasn't quite sure which facts give rise to the non-conformity in that situation. It can hardly be held that my client knew. And with this, since I see my time has more than elapsed, I would conclude by asking you to dismiss the claims that the claimant has brought forward and order the claimant to bear the cost of the arbitration.
Thank you very much, and rebuttal is clear.
Just three brief points. The first, that the claimant did not order unsized squid. Its purchase order form did not specify unsized squid, and that would run contrary to every indication that the claimant had provided previously to the respondent, including the cover email accompanying that purchase order. Catch 2007-2008 was only included in the respondent's response, and the principle of contra proferentum should apply in interpreting how that would alter, if at all, the contract. Second, in terms of inspection, as to the adequacy of the inspection, inspecting the first two containers in the circumstances was appropriate, since the claimant had no idea of how many, if any, of the cartons contained in the containers were in fact 2008 squid. There was no indication as to how many there would be, and it's not for the claimant to prove a negative by trying to find a needle in a haystack searching for a 2008 carton to investigate. And lastly, it's almost a case of Nelsonian blindness for the respondent to say that it had no idea of the particular fact that each individual squid might be under 100 grams, when it did in fact know that any squid that was provided early in 2008, or caught early in 2008, would in fact most likely not be in conformity with the contract, and that those squid made up the bulk of the goods supplied.
Thank you, Mr. Hume. Well, we will obviously take time to consider and reflect this. So what were you envisaging?
I think we should just thank both the claimant and the respondent for this fantastic display of meeting in the CISB and International Arbitration. The other thing I did, before we can ask, we invite the floor to ask questions in regard to either the mooting as such or any kind of content, substance questions. I just would like to mention two additional points. So David Williams QC, as mentioned by the claimant, of course, is the New Zealand David Williams QC, just to make another addition that New Zealand does actually have something to do with international arbitration. And if you ever thought and relaxed and said the CISG has nothing to do with me, the squid case is actually a New Zealand case. So that's settled. This is why it's not gone through the courts. And that is why it was very suitable for the Vismut problem 2011. Yep. But it is a New Zealand case. So the CISG has come to the shores of New Zealand. And after that, anybody, any questions? Including our students.
Can I just make a point that the figures that you've been using are quite interesting, but you've not gone very far with them. You talked about 120 container or core cartons, right? And you talked about...
We have a microphone here, so thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. You talked about... Is it on?
Yes, it is.
Oh, thank you. You talked about there being 120 containers or cartons, but it's 120 was a figure that you used.
No, there were 12 containers and 20 cartons. 12 containers was the whole that was delivered, and 20 cartons were actually were inspected. I left that bit out.
I think where I was coming from is that I wrote down that you had 120, and that you had 48 came from 2007, and 72 from 2008.
That was the testing agency that the claimant, after the non-conformity happened, has been detected, or probably been detected, ordered to conduct an inspection. It wasn't the first inspection that under the CSG the buyer has to do when the delivery has been made. This was the inspection that, for preservation of evidence, really was made after everything had gone wrong already. Those were the 120.
But you did talk about 120. Let me go one way through and you'll see where I'm coming from. And you said there were five companies that were supplying with the squid.
So the claimants, the supplied, in a back-to-back kind of sense, five trawlers.
Five trawlers.
Squid. Yeah.
Two used the squid, supplied, and five came back.
Two came back of the five, and three stayed out at sea.
Oh, three stayed out. Okay. The reason why I was coming for that is because if I can remember correctly, you had 72 in the 2008 and 24 in the 2007. If you divide by five, you'll come back to two and three. And my thought was, I thought it was three stayed at sea and two came back. Three came back and two stayed at sea. So,
well, I bet the people who stayed at sea didn't use the bait because it was unusable.
But
so they might have stayed at sea.
The two trawlers that stayed out got the 2007 because it was 2/3 of the patch, and the three that came back got the 2008.
Well, I have no information. That was all the claimant that did that. So.
I wonder why it just struck me as figures that turned up.
Sadly,
purposely done.
Sadly, for the purposes of time, I may have skated over some thin ice and didn't recruit especially an expert in accounting to collect all of those squid. But suffice to say that that's probably an issue that's been picked over in the Bismuth when this issue was raised. I don't know if anyone experienced it when they were there, but yeah, it's this problem kind of lends itself to those kinds of issues cropping up. It's a very interesting dynamic at the Bismuth when it does get opened up for debate.
Actually, the microphone's actually working terribly well.
I'm not sure that it is. I'd just like to explore a little further the decoration of the relationship aspect, and perhaps, especially from the tribunal, perhaps if you don't mind, your views of really some of the nuances that were raised. Should it be more prudent for the declaration to be made ahead of time, and rather than take the risk of increasing the chance of an appeal, challenging the award at a future date?
Well, I would have thought to start with, it would have been something that would have been disclosed. It's clearly a relationship that should have been disclosed in terms of the rules. One could split hairs about the professional and personal and godmothers being different from others, but I would have thought that the relationship should actually have been disclosed. So that would be the first point. Whether it would be at a stage where the president should withdraw voluntarily might be a matter of debate. Whether it would be something that the president would be removed if it went through the proper processes, again, might be a matter of debate. The interesting question to me is the removal of counsel and when one might remove counsel. One thing that, of course, would probably happen in that case is that the claimant would be left with the choice of either having the risk of the president being removed or actually just dropping Dr. Mercado from the team, and I suspect they'd probably drop from the team. There is an issue, of course, which I didn't raise.
as to the fact that she has been involved up to this point, and whether and that, because that was going to just get too complicated in the very short timeframes we have. But one issue may well be whether, in fact, the involvement of her for that period had actually, especially without disclosure, because as soon as you have a non-disclosure of those sort of relationships, then there is an issue about possibly a justifiable issue. Now, there wasn't an issue of actual bias being alleged, but on the other hand, they did put those previous arbitrations beforehand, and so there is that, and I mean, one can understand why actual bias isn't alleged, because it's not terribly politic if you're actually then going to be landing up with the tribunal. But on the other hand, I think there was enough there that maybe even so, it would be something that the president should actually withdraw, and probably something that if it went down to it, that would be the case. So in fact, getting rid of the council may not have been the appropriate issue. Of course, all of these issues are very difficult ones, but that's just a few thoughts on that particular issue. I mean, I'm not sure if other people have a different view on that, but I'd be out the door, I think.
Yeah, I just can add that the issue is there's basically no case law except those, there's three exit cases, plus two American decisions, which unfortunately each goes each way on the whole issue. So it is something which actually is explored at Vienna this year. There was an international arbitration conference which explored exactly those issues. And those arbitrators and experts were actually relatively divided on how to deal with removal of counsel.
I could also add David Williams was on the working group that drafted the IBA guidelines, and there are some international arbitral rules now which are updating to anticipate that very scenario with a member of the legal team might be.
Just also, there may be an issue too, a difference, because in that particular case, the person was actually appearing as against one of the members of the background team. And I think there might be issues, because there could well be, in large firms, people who've done some work on it. So it wasn't entirely clear to me, I must say, the knowledge that the president might have had in terms of disclosing of the existence of counsel until it was actually brought up, because it wasn't someone, in fact, actually appearing.
So the quick question about the convention. The articles that were reproduced in the materials referred to the buyer losing the right to rely on lack of conformity. So if there is a lack of conformity, you have a right to rely on it. But it doesn't say specifically what you can do if you can rely on someone. Are there any specific remedies other than, there's obviously an implied remedy of applying for seeking damages. Is there a specific right to reject goods that don't conform?
Well, we don't have an explicit remedy, right of rejection. There is a range of remedies under the convention, avoid the contract, damages, which are damages is certainly the most important one by far. There is, in certain situations, a right for specific performance. As far as I can see, never exercise in practice, but still there, and potentially concerned for some common lawyers. There is a sort of escape clause that would allow a common law court not to award such a right if he wouldn't do so under his own law. And there is no specific right to reject. That is impliedly drawn from a number of provisions from the convention. That is not a matter which is entirely undisputed. But I believe the prevailing opinion nowadays has it that the buyer has the right to reject goods that are not conforming. We don't have a specific provision to that, but at least the CDG Advisory Council has so concluded, I understand, under certain conditions. So yes, it's there.
I just add to that as well that, just for common words, there's also the added wrinkle of when there's non-conformity, if you want to walk away from the contract, there's a small hurdle you have to get over, which is the fact that the seller has effectively a right to cure potentially, and that's where the notification also becomes important. That's why there's Sir Jervis is placed on it so that you notify as soon as possible so that they can make every effort to keep the contract on foot and so you don't get to just drop hands.
Any further questions? If not, I think we close this arbitration. And thank you for listening. Thank you, Susan, for everybody else for participating.